How y'all doing?
Good.
I'll do that again. Good evening.
Good evening.
Good. That was a little bit better there. We got some here, some missing, some still at parties and what have you. Glad to see someone be here. I'll be at Restle this afternoon. I'll be truthful, I didn't. I think I did. I may have dozed off. I'm not sure. Two guys are playing tennis. I woke up, two other guys are playing, so I think I could have dozed off or something. Anyway, if you would, find the hymn book and welcome to our service tonight. We come to sing, pray, listen to the word of God to us. If we have open hearts, open minds, and this one we haven't sung in a long, long time. But it's number 63, Abide With Me. That's my fault for not singing, because I'm the music director, and they say if you don't sing, you're the one in charge. Anyway, Abide With Me, 63, we'll do all four verses together. Mansion over the hilltop. It's on page 881. And we're going to sing all both verses. I repeat the chorus at the end. 881, Mansion Over the Hilltop.
The rest of the shine, I
We've heard the joyful sound, Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Thank God he does. Jesus saves. We're going to sing all four verses. That's 581. We have heard the joyful sound. Join us as we sing. Song that no apologies. I'm getting raspy, but just found out that our pitch control upstairs is not working. And this may be kind of high than what I want to do, but it's a song, it's a great song, and all of us probably in the same category, we don't realize a lot of times, but it's simply entitled Drinking from a Saucer.
Yes, and that makes me rich enough.
the mercies he's bestowed. I'm drinking from my saucer, 'cause my cup has overflowed. Oh, sure, I've been through some storms in my life. Well, yes, there were times when my faith may have got just a little thin. But you know, one day, what it seems like all at once, those old clouds broke, that sun comes shining through again. So, Lord, help me not to grumble or complain about the tough roads I have hauled. I'm drinking from my saucer, 'cause my cup has overflowed. And if I should go on if my way gets steep and tough, I would ask for other blessings, Lord, 'cause I'm already blessed enough.
Take your Bible tonight and
turn to the book of Revelation, chapter 6. We're going to pick up where we left off last week in just a moment. I do, however, I want to, at the beginning of tonight, and this will probably be something that happens more than to just tonight, is kind of update on some things that, as I said this morning, have happened within the last 24 hours or so, last week, within the last, say, 2 weeks. Now, time gets by me, and sometimes my week is 3 weeks. I don't know if anybody else would like but in my mind, what's all this point back there? Other people do that thing? Within the last 2 weeks or so, you may have seen a headline. A good source for your phone without having to listen to all the trash on TV is Gateway Pundit. Just getting that out, and you'll get these news things through Facebook, wherever the case may be. But approximately 2 weeks ago, Iran announced that they are fully capable of building a bomb. And we have been discussing these things and what that means on the world scene, and of course, Israel's reaction. you may or may not be aware also that Israel is going to have another election soon. And it does appear that the Benjamin Netanyahu will win again. He doesn't have a lot of backing in parliament, but he's got a backbone like no other in Israel.
Amen.
And this all coming into play. It's not by chance. This is God's sovereign timing. You're just going to want, let's just sit back and watch. Well, that's true to a degree. It's just we're involved too. And I say we is people and things affecting us. So anyway, watching that. Also, you may have seen, I didn't put the story on there. I did put something on our church Facebook page this week. Perhaps you saw it with the leaders of Russia, Iran, and Turkey holding hands together. And these type things are coming. I just simply put Ezekiel 38. I mean, I've seen a lot of different things where people have put different things, and that's fine. But if you know, you know. And that's kind of the reason I put that there. Also, we have seen where in the last 24 hours or so, if you go to Gateway Pundit, look there, you will see that Russia and China have developed a reserve currency that they just announced during the night last night. And I get in trouble quick trying to explain all this stuff. My son is the expert in all this, and maybe one day I can get him to get up here and talk about all these type things in relation to world currency and cryptocurrency and all this stuff, how it fits together. But just keep that in mind. There's a word that I'm looking for here, but it's pitted against the U.S. dollar. And so something to watch there. And it seems like there's one other thing, and I'll remember it tomorrow. But if you'll turn in your Bibles to the book of Revelation chapter 6, when we last met, we left, shall we say, kind of in the middle of this particular seal judgment, the fourth seal, Revelation chapter 6, beginning in verse 7. And I want to look at something specific in that passage before we move forward. Revelation chapter 6, verse number 7 says, "And when he had opened the fourth seal, I heard a voice of the fourth beast come and see." And this word "see" here means it means come and behold the results of the open seal. Verse 8 says, "And I looked, and behold, a pale horse. And his name that sat on him was Death, and hell followed him." We talked about physical death and spiritual death, of course, with all the many, many, many lost souls on earth. And we're going to address that in just a minute, and just shortly. "And power was given unto them over one-fourth part of the earth to kill with sword, with hunger, and with death, and with beasts of the earth." And we looked at, of course, the approximate population of this day. And we're talking about, you know, somewhere around 1.75 billion with a B as in boy, deaths from this particular seal judgment. I want to read something to you. For you Faith Bible Institutes, you have a different textbook now, but this used to be your textbook. If you see one of these, this is Wilmington's Guide to the Bible. Brother Harold Wilmington, Dr. Harold Wilmington, Liberty University. He's been dead a few years now, a couple of years. If you happen to see one of these anywhere in a bookstore, they bill click, you get it. If they've got ten of them, you get them. Okay. And we'll make sure there'll be buyers for them. Okay. This is one of the greatest Bible textbooks that's ever been written. It's not, shall we say, as thorough as I would like, but there's information here you can't or haven't been able to get anywhere else. This particular, it was written in 1981, so what I'm about to read to you in just a moment is dated a little bit, at least by the population. And so listen to me here as I read this passage. Here as it speaks about what we've just read when it says, to kill with sword, with hunger, and with death, and with the beast of the earth. With the beast of the earth is what we're going to look at right now. Starting here, let me read this part. It says, the damage done by these riders, 1/4 of all humanity perishes during this plague. It is estimated that during the Second World War, 1 out of every 40 persons lost their lives. But this sealed judgment alone will claim 1 out of 4. Nearly 1 billion human beings. So you see the dated material in 1981. We note the phrase with the beast of the earth. Okay. Now, the beasts are closely linked with the pestilence, and this might be a clue. The most destructive creature on earth, as far as mankind is concerned, is not the lion or the bear, but the rat. The rat is clever, adaptable, destructive. If 95% of the rat population is exterminated in a given area, the rat population will replace itself within 1 year. It has killed more people than all the wars in history and makes its home wherever man is found. Rats carry as many as 35 diseases. Again, this is written in 1981. That number has probably climbed. Their fleas carry bubonic plague, which killed 1/3 of the population of Europe in the 14th century. Their fleas also carry typhus, which in 4 centuries has killed an estimated 200 million people. Beasts in this passage are linked not only with pestilence, but with famine. Rats menace human food supplies, which they both devour and contaminate, especially in the more underdeveloped countries, which can least afford to suffer loss. Now, keeping in mind what we've watched over the last 2+ years with this pandemic and with the Wuhan virus and the development of the Chinese labs and other viruses that we're now finding out that they are developing and have developed. George Soros, okay, being one of the main three, says, while the greater part of a city's population could be destroyed by an atomic bomb, the bacteria method may easily wipe out the entire population within a week. The virus causing parrot fever, one of the most deadly of human diseases, is appraised by scientists as being the most preferable for this purpose. While the cost of producing silicosis bombs is comparatively cheap, its lethal potency is extremely high. Says here that less than 1 cubic centimeter of this virus is required to infect 20 million human beings when released in the air. And so just as a side note, there is no restraint to wickedness. And we looked at that in a different capacity this morning as we looked at passages that related to the days of Noah. Again, in our study on Wednesday nights and looking at that time period prior to the flood. But of course, again, one of the things to keep in mind, we've already talked about this at least 2 times, but I do need to mention this, but as in our study, is remember that when the rapture takes place, okay, the restrainer is removed in that, as far as that part of his ministry, okay, restrainer being the Holy Spirit of God. So again, a lot of things are very, very possible. Now, as we get to the 5th seal, we've gone through the first 4 seal judgments up to this point, okay. But as we get to the 5th seal, okay, the 5th seal is occurring at the midpoint of the tribulation period, the 3.5 year mark. So we're going to put our brakes on right there as far as the seals go. what I want us to do is to as close as possible, I want us to look at the results, the things that occur after the rapture occurs, church, in chronological order, or at least within a time period close to that. So for our purposes, I want to stay within the first 3.5 years for right now. So we're going to move, we're going to put the brakes on right here. We're not going to move into the fifth seal. We're going to stop. I'm going to have you turn in your Bible to the book of, same book of Revelation, but chapter 11. Chapter 11. One of the things that you're going to see, and again, my purpose in doing it, we're not studying through the book of Revelation. We will do that later on at some point. I just want us to look at events as they take place chronologically, and that's what we're going to do. We're going to follow this all the way through the tribulation period, Battle of Armageddon, into the millennial reign of Christ, the great white throne judgment, so on and so forth. But I want us to look tonight, as we continue right now, at Revelation chapter 11. And we're going to look at another group of people here in just a bit. But you are, I'm certain, I would imagine, most people are aware that there will be multitudes of people that are saved during the tribulation period. Now, I want to be careful in that, because we may actually have a message dealing with that next Sunday morning. But I want us to understand there will be lots and lots and lots and lots and lots and lots and lots of folks saved. Okay? And I want to start this discussion, or as we move into this passage, again by emphasizing the chaos and the panic. Keeping that in mind, because we're going to come back to that in just a little bit. But we have two specific groups that are mentioned in the book of Revelation, okay, as being, shall we say, evangelists or preachers during that period of time. One is a little bitty group, and another one is a great big group. Okay? And the first one that I want to mention tonight is found in the book of Revelation, chapter 11. Okay? Now, we're going to talk about, for a little bit, we're going to talk about the two witnesses. Now, let me just say this. We are not going to spend time on trying to figure out who it is. Okay? We could all sit in the room, a cup of coffee, and we could go back and forth, and there's things here, there's things there, this might, and that's all, you know, that's fine, that's fine. But that's not our purpose, so let's just move into this. But what we do need to see here is in verse number 1 and verse number 2, as we start into this chapter, these references here are being made to the temple, the rebuilt or rebuilding of the temple during the tribulation period. And there's references here to measurements, and there's references here to leaving a certain portion out. That's the porch of the Gentiles, okay? And there's references here that we'll see here specific to the Gentiles. So let me just read through verse 1 and 2. It says, "And there was given me a reed like unto a rod, and the angel stood, saying, Rise and measure the temple of God." Okay, this is the tribulation temple, by the way. "And them that worship therein, and the court which is without," or outside the temple, "leave out." Okay, that's the court of the Gentile. "And measure it not, for it is given unto the Gentile." So we have a back and forth here in this passage, and sometimes it does get, a bit confusing trying to follow, you know, along a timeline specific, okay? Because what we're looking at here, up until this point, up until that period, okay, shall we say, is the preparation period and the building and everything that has to do with the temple all the way up until the exact midpoint, 1260 days in, Daniel 9:27, when the Antichrist shall go into the Holy of Holies and declare himself God. Okay, that's what's happened. That's where this period is, shall we say, here in verse number 2. Unto the Gentiles. That's not a period, that's a semicolon. Not a semicolon. What is that? Somebody help me.
Colon.
Okay. Time out. Ms. Lynn, I've got a job for you.
Okay. for the next 15 to 25 years that I'm here.
Okay.
When I have an English question and I can't figure it out and I look to you, do not under any circumstances have a blank look on your face.
It could happen.
What that means is that she couldn't figure out what I was getting at. Anyway, so we're here there, that the Gentile. Then we have the word and. We go from the first 3.5 years to what happens at the midpoint and afterwards. This is when the tremendous amount of persecution starts, the midway period. Not to say that there's none at the first, but it grows exponentially afterwards. It says, and the holy city shall they tread underfoot 42 months. That's the last 3.5 years. Then we get to verse number 3. Basically, what God's done is said here is going to have a temple at the first part. There's going to be bad stuff happening at the second. But follow me here because I have a plan. In verse number 3, he says, and I will give power unto my two witnesses. It says, and they shall prophesy 1,260 days. 1,260 days, first half of tribulation. Remember, these are 30-day months. All right? Clothed in sackcloth. Verse number 4 here is a reference here to prophecy made in Zechariah chapter 4. Okay, we're not going to go there. You can make a little note and go back and study this. It says, these are the two olive trees and the two candlesticks, or literally lampstands, standing before the God of the earth. Okay, that's a reference there in Zechariah. Verse 5 says, and if any man will hurt them, or try, or there's danger, is really a reference. The fire proceedeth out of their mouth and devoureth their enemies. And if any man will hurt them, he must be in this manner be killed. Okay, so they will have tremendous powers on this earth during this time period. All of this is happening in and immediately around Jerusalem. Okay, verse number 6 says, these have power or authority to shut heaven that it rain not in the days of their prophecy, and have power over waters to turn them to blood. And say, well, this is all crazy stuff. All this stuff has already happened before. All this stuff has already happened in the Old Testament multiple times. Nothing new. Power over the waters to turn into blood and to smite the earth with all plagues as often as they will. Now, stop a minute. Back to the chaos. Back to the panic. And this that I'm mentioning, folks, cannot be understated, okay, or overstated, excuse me, because it's going to fuel, shall we say, the mind of man over all of this earth. Now, we're going to see this also when we get to the 144,000 here in just a little bit. But I want us to stop here for just a minute. Understand that when our feet leave this earth, okay, assuming that we're alive when the rapture takes place, and, you know, I sure hope so. I think it's very, very possible. Again, remember, let's just say it happened today sometime in the early afternoon, okay? How long do you think it would take on news stations, radio, this, that, and other? Breaking news. Breaking news. You got the obvious things of car crashes taking place everywhere. Airplane crash, all this stuff. People go into the vehicle, there's no driver there. But I just saw that vehicle hit that tree. I was right there. And there's nobody there. And this is going to be happening on a worldwide scale. Okay? And we're just grazing the surface here. So breaking news comes on. Trying to, they're showing all the pictures of all the accidents, all the stuff going on everywhere. And so somebody has to explain this. So it won't take long for the crackpots to come out, because they're all be crackpots. Everybody's slept.
That's right.
So the most obvious thing is alien abduction.
Yeah,
Have you noticed that in the future, that in the last, say year, two, 3 years, there's more fascination with that type thing? And so it's been mentioned over and over and over and over, all these other kind of things. But that's one of the things that'll be mentioned right away. Alien abduction. And then they can come up with other stuff. But at some point, they're just going to say, it really don't matter where they're gone. We're just glad they are gone. You know, Jesus Christ told us that the world hates us.
That's right.
And we see that every single day. We see that in policies of governments. We see that in policies of companies and their stances for immorality and all these type things. And then on and on and on and on we could go. So we see all these things. Okay. All right. There's always the voice of the heathen media, but there's also people that don't always buy what they're being sold.
Right.
And they're going to be, and I'm going to show you in Scripture in a minute, prove this, there's going to be untold thousands and tens of thousands and millions of people on this earth that don't buy it.
That's right.
There are going to be a lot of people that in flicking through on a TV channel, that had watched a faithful preacher give the gospel and maybe just continued on and never did pay attention to it, that maybe saw, you know, had a co-worker that carried a Bible and saw them praying. There's going to be questions that are asked. Now, these are going to be people that were never convicted to be saved prior to the rapture, folks. Okay. But there are going to be millions and millions and millions of people that are going to have questions. Perhaps that were given a tract once upon a time. Listen to me. They're going to remember a piece of paper that said something about such and such, and in their mind it kind of bothered worthy. I got to find that and see what it said. I'm skipping ahead just a little bit to the 3.5 year mark in this one I'm about to tell you, in as far as the intense persecution of the Jews, okay? But how many of you have heard of a place called Petra? Okay, the FBI statement, y'all know that y'all have. Y'all are very, very familiar with this. In the Bible, references to Edom. This is where Petra is located. Okay. What's the movie, Caleb? Raiders of the Lost Ark?
Mm-hmm.
Raiders of the Lost Ark. When they're riding their horses through this area, this carved city, that's where this is, by the way. Okay. But back in the early 80s, okay, Dr. Harold Wilmington took students, scores of students there, and they hid gospel tracts and Bibles, okay, many written in Hebrew languages, this, that, and another, in the city of Petra, okay? And so those type things, you know, people can get their hands on something, okay? There are going to be people breaking into houses to get food, and guess what? There's going to be a Bible sitting there. And, you know, they're talking together. They've been away at that house there all week. Let's go down there. And they go in there, and there's a Bible sitting there. All these type things. I saw yesterday, and again, I'm just recalling what I think I saw. I remember the most important parts, okay? And so just bear with me. If you saw it, then you saw it too. But one particular ministry that was giving out a lot of Bibles, they had sat down with all the people, and they had taken a highlighter and highlighted all the verses about salvation in it before they gave them out to people, okay? So these type things. People, God is going to lead people to his word, okay? We have in this, shall we say, an explanation of sorts in a little bit different way of Romans chapter 1. Right? You don't know what I'm talking about? Go home and read that. So, we have this taking place. Now let's pick up again with the two witnesses. Verse 2 says, and when they shall have finished their testimony, or their time, their appointed time on this earth, which was 1260 days, you saw this earlier. You say, a whole lot of time sure did go past this couple of verses. says, and when they shall have finished their testimony, the beast, this is the Antichrist, and yes, we will get to a point where we take a specific look at the Antichrist himself, but that's not tonight, not right now. The beast that ascendeth out of the bottomless pit shall make war against them, and shall overcome them, and shall kill them. Okay? Not until God finishes with them. Verse 8 says, and their dead bodies, watch this, their dead bodies shall lie in the street of the great city. Okay, this is Jerusalem, but look what God has to say about them, which spiritually is called Sodom and Egypt, where also our Lord was crucified. They're in bad shape spiritually. And they of the people, literally peoples, and kindreds, okay, and tongues, different languages, and nations shall see their dead bodies 3 days and a half, and shall not suffer or allow their dead bodies to be put in graves. Now let's look at verse number 9 here, and let's roll back 100, 150 years, 200 years, 300 years, 500 years, 1,000 years to this passage. Brother Mike Verlicker, let's just say if the year 1700, you sitting in your cabin, okay, up in West Virginia, and you got your rifle there, you know, because there's some dangerous stuff around going around you. And then, but you out there with a little light, last light of the day, and you read God's word and read the book of Revelation, and you get to verse number 9, and you read this and say, they shall see all these people all around the world going, how? And you go sit there and you're gonna shake your head, and you're just gonna close your Bible, and you're gonna sit over and you're gonna pick up your cup of coffee and say, ain't no way that can happen. You know what, at that time it couldn't have happened, could it? But now, okay, with satellite, with everything going on, we've watched recently how governments have completely taken over their news sources, okay, and state-controlled media, and any channel you turn to, they have their information on it. So if you, they could be sitting there trying to think of something since over the Netherlands, over in Switzerland, up there in a mountain, they're sitting there with a rare back watching Gone with the Wind. But guess what's up there in the corner? There's them two guys laying on the street. Sitting there watching, wife walks in an hour later, they still there? Yep, they still there. And this is happening on a worldwide scale. Continuing our reading. Verse 10 says, and they that dwell on the earth shall rejoice over them, okay, and make merry, and shall send gifts to one another. Depravity has no boundaries. Because these two prophets tormented them that dwell on the earth. Remember the authority that they were given in bringing plagues and all this stuff happening on a worldwide scale? Okay. They did. And they just lay there. And they're just laying there. Verse 11 says, and after 3 days and a half, the spirit of life from God entered into them. Can you imagine sitting there watching Gone with the Wind after 3 days and leaning on a picture, and you in the corner of your eye, you catch it moving, they standing up? Entered them, they stood upon their feet, great fear fell upon them which saw them. And they heard a great voice from heaven saying unto them, come up hither. And they ascended up to heaven in a cloud, and their enemies beheld them.
Amen.
Verse 13 says, in the same hour was there a great earthquake, and the tenth part of the city, 10% of the city of Jerusalem, fell or collapsed in rubble, and the earthquake was slain of men 7,000, and the remnant were affrighted. And gave glory to the God of heaven. This is all occurring. This occurs day 1260. Okay. Keeping this in mind, let's go back to chapter 7. Verse 1. It says, "And after these things, I saw four angels standing on the four corners of the earth, holding the, you know, the extreme north, extreme, you know, all these other type things, holding four winds of the earth, that the wind should not blow on the earth, nor the sea, nor on any tree, till all the winds cease." This point. "And I saw another angel ascending from the east, having the seal of the living God. And he cried with a loud voice to the four angels to whom it was given to hurt the earth and the sea." Verse 3 says, "Saying, hurt not the earth, neither the sea, nor the trees, till we have sealed the servants of our God in their foreheads." Verse 4 says, "And I heard the number of them which were sealed, and there were sealed 144,000 of all the tribes of the children of Israel." Okay. Now, the Bible is very, very plain of who this is. It's not the Jehovah's Witnesses. It's not any other cult, okay, that have announced or have said that, that, you know, there's going to be 144,000, and there's more than one, by the way. We see where they come from, of the tribes of the children of Israel. Okay? Following here from verse number 5, and we're not going to read through all of these tribes, okay? But let's just look at verse 5. It says, "Of the tribe of Judah were sealed how many?" 12,000. 12 times 12 is what? 144. Had a Jehovah's Witness come to my door one time. And there's times where I wouldn't get up, I'll just be honest. I mean, I'm, yeah. You know, I've had the conversations and just. But this particular day, I decided, okay, I'm going to talk to these people. I believe in steering a conversation. These type of things here, it's like when a game warden comes. Now, Brother Jim, y'all have seen him rear his head back there. Like when a game warden comes to me, Brother Ray, if he even gets close to me on the water, I'm going to him in my boat. I'm going to get my stuff out. I'm going to lay it out there. I'm going to put it on a boat seat. I'm going to hand it over to him. And I'm going to keep him so busy talking, he can't wait to get away from me. I've been doing that for years. It's always worked. They don't ever ask to check your ice chest. Haven't you? If you don't understand what that means, don't even worry about it. Okay, let's just move on. Okay. So, this Jehovah's Witness, okay, these two ladies. So I meet them out there, you know, "Hello, my name's so-and-so, kind of by such and such." And they immediately, you know, "We're Jehovah's Witnesses." And I said, "Hold on. Ma'am, what did you say your name was?" She'd tell me. And I asked her, I said, "What tribe are you from?" And I always get the same look. It's just a look of shock. And I wish we wasn't here. Okay. I said, "Man, what tribe did you say you was from?" Well, and I said, you know, and I've got it, I take my Bible out there with me. And I said, "Let me read something to you. Here's what God said. Of the tribe, 12,000. I just want to know what tribe you're from." And usually she'll mumble, yada yada, and I don't ever give her a chance to get mine out. And I go to the next one. By the time I get through with her, they're ready to get in a car and leave. Okay? Listen, folks. I've said this before. Whatever cult somebody's in, they can come up and they can take a passage of scripture and twist it. And have you sound so sam flamboozled, you don't know what to do. Okay? And so that's why sometimes I don't leave open door. Most of the time. So, we see verses 5 here through 8, these 12 tribes that are named. Later on, we'll get into talking about tribes and why there's two that's not mentioned here, and why two are. Okay? But look at verse number 9. It says, "After this," literally at the conclusion of their ministry, okay, which of course would include the two witnesses, says, after this I beheld, and lo, a great multitude, which no man could number, of all nations and kindreds and people and tongues, stood before the throne and before the Lamb, clothed in white robes and palms in their hands. Okay? All right. These at this point here, these are those that have been martyred, okay, during the persecution of the tribulation. Okay? And we'll speak of all this later on. But hey, a great multitude which no man could number of all, that's a lot of folks.
Amen.
The greatest revival that will have ever taken place will take place during that period of time, those years. So we see at this point, we see the two witnesses and 144,000. This morning, we made a reference. We talked about the people as in the days of Noah. I finished with this on Wednesday night. We spoke about God's love for people, specific to different individuals, even loved homosexuals. Okay? Loves people. We talked about his deadline. We see in 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 9, it talks about his long suffering. And folks, we need to understand. One of the reasons why we were put on this earth was to worship God, to glorify Him.
Amen.
To glorify Him. We talked about the other night as we looked at the days of Noah and the rampant, extreme, shall we say, demonic possession during that time period, again, as being a tool of Satan to destroy the seed of woman in Genesis chapter 3, verse number 15. And we need to understand in our mind that we need to look at world events. We need to look at, obviously, spiritual events, the things of this world. We need to look at it through the Word of God itself and understand that there is a spiritual war going on, taking place, okay, between God and Satan. Now, when I say that, I cringe a little bit. Because sometimes people automatically get the idea that there's two equal forces here, back and forth, okay? And of course we remind ourselves and know the Word of God that Lucifer was a created being that was not created in the image of God, and he hates God. We see this in the book of Isaiah, we see it also in the book of Ezekiel, okay? But Satan is trying to do everything he can to destroy the things of God, to destroy God himself and take the throne. Now, folks, we know that's not going to happen.
Amen.
Ms. Penny, you put it on Facebook this week, didn't you?
What?
About little battles, big battles, and that God wins in the end. It was on your page. That may be your hacked page. Somebody's took over a page in the last couple of days, but they had that part right. Folks, God's going to receive glory even during the tribulation period.
Amen.
With a level of wickedness that we can't in our minds even imagine. But the great I Am will receive glory.
Amen.
No matter what. Flipping ahead real quick, one passage that we didn't look at, I just thought of this, and then we want to say this. Remember at the beginning there, of chapter 7, when the 144,000 were sealed, and they went through all the stuff there, and persecutions and attacks and all this other kind of stuff. Remember last week, we talked about, as a child of God, how we're safe within the hands of God. Okay? Now, he sealed 144,000 at the beginning. I wonder how many showed up back in heaven. Well, we find out. It just so happened, glad you asked that question. Because it just so answers that question in chapter 14. 14 verse 1 says, and I looked, and lo, a Lamb stood on the Mount of Zion, and with him 144,000 having his Father's name. That's the seal. Written in a forehead. How many? Every single one. That's our God. There's so many things in these passages, so many things as we go through this study that, you know, we understand parts. There's some things we just can't understand, not all things. But one thing is very, very clear. God's glory never takes second place in the enterprise of this earth. Ever, ever. Let's pray. Father, we thank you. God, as we study these passages and as we're about to move more soon into a different area of this period, God, we call upon you, Lord, to speak to our hearts. God, give us understanding as we study, as we read, Lord, and as we seek, God, again, not just so that we have knowledge, not just so that we can, after we finish, look back and say that I was part of a study and that I found out this, or I had a question answered about this, or whatever the case may be. But God, that we learn these things in light of, and God, that we allow you, Lord, to greater burden our hearts, Lord, for the lost. For those that you put on our hearts, for those that we toss at turn in night thinking of, Father, that we're praying for. It's in Jesus' precious name we pray.